always gives me pleasure to present one of the three wonderful leaders we have here in the New York Society. And I mean that sincerely. I think we're lucky to have the people that we have as our leaders. I'd like to introduce to you again Dr. Anne Klaeysen, and she's going to give us a tribute to Fathers.
Thank you, Mommy. I'm going to start with a tribute to Rose, Widow Rose. I have Rose's photograph there. Some of you know already, Rose Walker, a dearly beloved member here of the New York Society, and also a member of the Brooklyn Society as well, died on June 17th at the age of 101.
Oh, wow.
So here, this is for Rose. Rose, one of my many mothers. How many of you here today are fathers? Raise your hands. Happy Father's Day to all of you. How many of you have fathers? Okay, I'm going to give you, all of you, an opportunity later in my platform to come up here and take one of the flowers. You'll see we've got a nice variety. So sort of think ahead of time, you know, which flower might best suit your father and a story about him. And then put it into the vase. We also have a wireless mic up here so we can all hear your stories. I have a first poem about fathers. And I was thinking, you know, there are so many men who become fathers intentionally, and too many, perhaps, who become fathers accidentally. And perhaps those who become fathers accidentally then become intentional fathers. And how wonderful that is for them and for their families. This is a poem by Tom Hunley, and it's called Father to the Man. The OBGYN said babies almost never arrive right on their due dates. So the night before my firstborn was due to make his debut, I went out with the guys, until a guilt twinge convinced me to convince them to leave the sports bar and watch game 6 on my 20-inch rabbit-eared crap TV. After we arrived, my wife whispered, "My water broke." As the guys cheered and spilled potato chips for our little dog to eat up, I can't remember who was playing whom, but someone got a call for a technical, and as the crowd made a noise that could have been a quick wind, high-fiving leaf after leaf after leaf, I grabbed our suitcase and told the guys they could stay put, but we were heading for the hospital and the rest of our lives. "No, we're out of here," they said. Part of me wanted to head out with them, back to the smell of hot wings and microbrews, then maybe to a nightclub full of heavy bass and perfume, or just into a beer Ford with a full ashtray, speeding farther and farther into the night, into nowhere in particular. Instead, I walked my wife to our minivan, held her hand as she stepped down from the curb, opened her door, shut the suitcases of the trunk, and ran right over that part of me, left it bleeding and limping like a poor, stupid squirrel. So, yeah, kind of an interesting poem, isn't it? But I think it speaks to some of the mixed feelings that, you know, that men have. Men approach fatherhood in a different way than women approach motherhood. And there could be so many different reasons for that. Part of it could be, and I think that I've gone over this with my husband Glenn, who I think is a wonderful father, that we carry this child inside of us for 9 months. And our bodies are connected to them in a way that sadly, you know, the fathers never will be. And since I also nursed our children, It was a little more prolonged for Glenn. However, he took paternity leave. And he has the distinction of being the first person working for the city of New York, as far as we know, he worked for the Corporation Council, who actually took paternity leave for a spouse who was not ill. It was okay if your wife wasn't feeling well, but to have one who was perfectly happy and going back to work was a little unusual. But he did it anyway, and what a difference it made for everyone. I don't know that Andrew necessarily remembers that time, but we all do, and we remind him, and it's very special for Glenn. So let me talk a little bit about Father's Day, because, you know, fathers do kind of get short shrift, and there's a reason for that. Mother's Day came first. The idea of Father's Day, at least the credit for the idea of Father's Day, is given to Sonora Dodd, and she's from Spokane, Washington, and she was listening to a Mother's Day sermon in 1909, and she wanted a special day to honor her father, William Smart, a widowed Civil War veteran who was left to raise his six children on a farm. Now, that might not seem unusual. Of course, a man would raise his own children. But at that time, it was unusual. Many men would marry again immediately, not necessarily for love, but to have a mother for their children, or would send out their children to orphanages, or to have them work on someone else's farm. So the kind of devotion that Sonora's father showed, she felt was truly worthy of Father's Day. And a day in June was chosen for the first celebration, 101 years ago, June 19th, 1910, it was proclaimed by Spokane's mayor because it was the month of William Smart's birth. And then it became a presidential proclamation not until 1966, when President Lyndon Johnson designated the third Sunday in June. However, there was someone who came before her, and that often happens, doesn't it? Who gets the credit, who doesn't get the credit? So let me mention someone else. The actual first observance of Father's Day took place in Fairmont, West Virginia on July 5th, 1908, and it was organized by Grace Golden Clayton, who wanted to celebrate the lives of the 210 fathers who had been lost in the Monongahela mining disaster, which had happened several months earlier in West Virginia in December 1907. And it's possible that she, too, was influenced by Mother's Day that same year, which happened just a few miles away. She chose Sunday because it was nearest to the birthday of one of her relatives who died in that mine. So at any rate, we see that it was inspired by Mother's Day, and it was very important for these two women to honor fathers, in one case her own father, in another case the 210 fathers who had died in that awful accident. Well, what happened shortly thereafter was kind of interesting as well, because we experienced this certainly from Mother's Day, when we look at all the flowers that are sent out and all of that. Well, what happened was, and I'm looking for my notes, excuse me. Okay, the commercialization of Father's Day. Shortly after they actually established Father's Day, a National Father's Day Committee was started in New York City in the 1930s and 1938, and it was devised specifically for the purpose of promoting it, and it incorporated several trade groups, and the goal was to legitimize this holiday in the mind of people and to manage it as a commercial event in a more systematic way. Now, it always had the support of Sonora Dodd. She thought that was a good thing, because she thought if it became more commercialized, that more people would recognize it and would honor it. But, I mean, there was just, you know, no bars hold against this. It was commercialization all the way. Excuse my tongue. Anyway, in this respect, she's considered to be sort of the opposite of Anna Jarvis, who did not want Mother's Day to be commercialized. Indeed, Mother's Day started as an international day of peace, so we really didn't want it to be commercialized. However, it did proceed forward. Many merchants actually decided they were going to calculate how many fathers received Father's Day cards. In 1937, the Father's Day Council calculated that only one father in six had received a present. However, by the 1980s, the same council proclaimed that they had achieved their goal. The one-day event had become a three-week commercial event, a second Christmas. Its executive director explained back in 1949 that without the coordinated efforts of the council and the groups supporting it, the holiday would have disappeared altogether. So kind of an interesting way of looking at things, that they take responsibility for having continued Father's Day. Well, what's the situation today? What's the landscape in terms of fathers? How many are there? Well, in the United States, and these are some figures that come from the U.S. Census Bureau, there are 70.1 million estimated fathers across the nation. 25.3 million of those fathers are part of married couple families with children younger than 18. 1.8 million are single fathers. 15% of single parents are men. As you might expect, there are a higher percentage of women who are single parents. About 46% are divorced, 30% were never married at all, and 19% were separated, 6% were widowed. So you sort of get an idea of the fathers. These are figures from 1910. There's a whole section now on Mr. Mom. Do you remember that movie about Mr. Mom? Wife goes out to work, the husband stays home. The number of stay-at-home dads in 2010 was 154,000. These married fathers with children younger than 15 have remained out of the labor force for at least 1 year, primarily so they can take care of the family while their wives work outside the home. These children cared for 287,000 children. 16% in spring 2005 is the percentage of preschoolers regularly cared for by their fathers during their mother's working hours. So it's a small number, 154,000, nonetheless. I think that's remarkable. Let's look at child support payments. $2.8 billion is the amount of child support received by custodial fathers in 2007. They were due $4.3 billion. So apparently we have some slackers among women as well as slackers among men. In contrast, however, custodial mothers received $18.6 billion of the $29.8 billion that they should have received. So it's a little off. 45% of custodial fathers who received all child support that was due in 2007 is not significantly different from the corresponding percentage for custodial mothers. How much time do we spend with fathers? 53% and 17%. I'm sorry, and 71%. Those are the percentages of children younger than seven who ate breakfast and dinner respectively with their father every day in 2006. That's not bad. 53% had breakfast with their fathers, and 71% had dinner. The corresponding percentages with mothers is 58% and 80%, but that's not that much higher. I think dads are doing pretty well there. 36% of children younger than six who had 15 or more outings with their father in the last month is about 36%. And 66% of children younger than six who were praised three or more times a day by their fathers. And that comes from a Child's Day statistic from 2006. I found those interesting because I certainly have wonderful memories of my father, but I never thought to quantify them. And I never thought to quantify the figures from Glenn either, because I think so much of it comes in terms of the quality of the experience that we have with our fathers. When my son Andrew was, I don't know, maybe eight or nine, he came home one day and he said,
He asked,
when are you and Dad getting divorced? And I thought, gee, you know, I'm not always thrilled with Glenn, but I don't want to call a family at him. And I think that we behave ourselves, we, you know, we make an effort if we're gonna have a discussion, you know, to go outside or go on the roof or, you know, whatever. So I said, we're not getting divorced. Why would you think that? Well, everyone in my class's parents are getting divorced. And I thought about it, and I thought, yeah, I knew quite a few off the top of my head. And it must seem like that to an eight-year-old, that everyone's parents will eventually get divorced and one isn't gonna happen. And so, you know, anticipating his anxiety, I said, we're never getting divorced. And then he was too smart for that. And he said, Mom, never say never. So I said, let me put it this way. We're having a really good week. And I don't really anticipate it. You know, I really love your father, and I love, and he loves me. And more importantly, for you to know, we love you. And we would never do anything to hurt you. And that seemed to satisfy him because he ran off and I never heard about it again. But I thought about it again as I was preparing for today. And so I found a poem by Mark Halliday. And it's called Divorced Fathers and Pizza Crusts. The connection between divorced fathers and pizza crusts is understandable. The divorced father does not cook confidently. He wants his kid to enjoy dinner. The entire weekend is supposed to be fun. Kids love pizza. For some reason involving soft warmth and malleability, kids approve of melted cheese on pizza years before they will tolerate cheese in other situations. So the divorced father takes the kid and the kid's friends out for pizza. The kids each eat much faster than the dad before the dad has finished his second slice. The kids are playing a video game or being Ace Ventura or blowing spitballs through straws, making this hail that can't quite be cleaned up. There are four slices left, and the divorced father doesn't want them wasted. There has been enough waste already. He sits there in his windbreaker finishing the pizza. It's good, except the crust is actually not so great. After the second slice, the crust is basically a chore, so you leave it. You move on the next loaded slice. Finally, you are amid rims of crust. All this is understandable. There is no dark conspiracy. Meanwhile, the kids are having a pretty good time, which is the whole point. So the entire evening makes clear sense. Now the divorced father gathers the sauce-stained napkins for the trash and dumps them and dumps the rims of crust, which are not corpses, on a battlefield. Understandability fills the pizza shop so thoroughly, there's no room for anything else. Now he's at the door summoning the kids, and they follow. Of course they do. He's a dad. Isn't that sad? You see them, don't you? You see the divorced dads and that sadness, and you see them in the pizza parlor. My dad wasn't like that. My parents are still married after 64 years. And they didn't have the sort of traditional marriage of the 50s. I was born in 51. My dad was 35 when I was born, a little older. It was after World War II, of course. And my dad was one of 12 children living on a farm. And his father started working for another farmer, came over from the Netherlands. My grandfather was one of 17. If you're a farmer in the Netherlands, you know pretty soon there's not going to be enough land for all of you to have your own farm. So a lot of Dutch came to upstate New York, western New York, and that's where my father's people settled. So Grandpa was a hired hand on a farm, and unfortunately the farmer there died, but he took over. He took over the family and started another family with my grandmother. And many people think that my Aunt Lena is not my father's half-sister, but is a full sister. Chances are he got started on that family a little earlier. So, you got it? Anyway, Dad said that, you know, being one of 12, that he often felt like a farmhand. Because that was a farm economy. And if his father said to him, pass me the hammer, that may be as much of a conversation as he would have had with him all day. So, when he had children, he became an intentional father. Not an accidental one, not a farm economy one, but a real true father, and had conversations with all of us. And the best conversations we had was when we initially thought we were being punished, and that was, go to the garden and start weeding. So we'd be weeding, and before we'd know it, Dad would be in the next row. And then he'd get a little closer. And before we knew it, we'd be talking. And we'd be sort of talking about how we got into trouble and why we were sent out there in the first place. And then that didn't matter so much because we were talking about so many things. And Dad made it clear to all of us that he was always available for a good conversation. So with that, I'm going to start this off and invite you to come up and share some memories about your fathers. This is for Dad. Okay, is it working? It's working. Okay. Would you like to put a rose in? Would you like to stay there and I'll put something in for you?
Yes, please.
Okay. Speak directly into it.
Okay. My father was a mother to me because my mother was teaching children in Brooklyn in the New York City school system and was away all the time. So my father prepared the food, he cooked, and not only that, he was my first teacher. He taught me about language, how words were constructed of a root, a prefix, and sometimes a suffix. And as a consequence, I was very well educated in language and became a language teacher later on. But he was unique in that he was an ideologue. He was a vegetarian, he was a communist, and he was a a chiropractor. So all those disciplines were taught to me at a very young age. So that at the age of 10, I gave a lecture on chiropractic in my school. And as a consequence, my father was invited by my biology teacher to give a lecture on chiropractic. All I can say about my father is he played a very important role in my life. And he organized my psyche, so you could almost say, with his points of view. So whenever I think of my father, I think of all the areas in which he influenced me. And I became a psychoanalyst because I thought it was a discipline that could help humanity. And I was really following in my father's footsteps because he wanted to cure everybody with his vegetarianism, his chiropractic, and his belief in an ethical society. Okay, I'll leave it there.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My father's a survivor. He survived appendicitis at the age of 6. He's twice survived quadruple bypass. He survived rheumatic fever, and he's since had 3 stents put in to keep him going. And he's still alive, and he's 84, and right now he's happily in Amagansett with his second wife, his 2 children and their wives, and their grandson. And he's very happy.
Don't be shy, come on up here.
Okay, my brother's been dead about 60 years. But I liked him, and he was far from a perfect man, but I liked him. And then my wife and I have 2 kids, and being a father is terrific. But watching my kids, and especially my son, be a father, and the things that he does as a father, and both of my kids, being grandparents just has been a great thing for me, and being a father and a grandfather is a great thing.
Yes, I will. And don't limit to your own fathers. It's lovely to hear about your son being father.
Well, I was going to start out by saying my father was somewhat tyrannical, but I changed it to say he was a tyrant. But I'll try to focus on the good things. I think I inherited my sense of responsibility from my father. Like, he was a research chemist, and it was 6 feet of snow and the chickens needed to be fed, he'd find some way of getting there. And I also think I inherited from him my attending church or whatever religiously. So I attend ethical culture religiously. And to me, that means if I'm here in New York, I'm here at Ethical Culture on Sunday. And I think if my father were alive today, he wouldn't choose for me to be here. And by that, I mean not that I'd be dead, but that I wouldn't be at Ethical Culture.
Scott, and the Lynch was for some family member
in Georgia who was probably from Ireland. And I had a therapist once who said to me, you know, your parents were just average, regular parents. And she was so wrong. I was astonished at how wrong she was. My father was a brilliant, tortured man. He graduated one of those cum laudes from Wake Forest. My father and his two brothers were all deacons. He would very much approve of my membership in ethical culture. He served with distinction on the North Carolina Workers' Compensation Board. He was a U.S. commissioner. He taught himself to play the organ at age 40, which I really kind of envy him that, because now I'm 64 and I still can't play anything. And he founded, with a couple of other lawyers, the first country club in Charlotte, North Carolina, that admitted you didn't have to be a white Protestant to join this club. You know, your qualification for membership was that you wanted to join the club. And that was a really huge thing, and that club is still there. I think what I'd really like to say, Jerry, I was listening to the hype and I was in a terrible mood, and this music cheered me up so much, and I sat there and I thought, my dad would have loved this. So thank you so much.
Envious that every week I get to join this group, whereas he has to
So my father was one of five children. His name is Martin O'Connell, and he was the son of immigrants, Irish immigrants. And like a lot of Irish immigrants, they drank. And as it turned out, when I think of my father, I think of somebody who's very responsible and very good provider, not very expressive, but really successful, because his four siblings were all alcoholics, and he was not. He somehow, through luck or my mother or something, escaped that, and I've always been grateful for that.
I remember my father as being very kind and very caring, which I really appreciate. But recently, other people in my life have been having a hard time. I had time with their parents, as their parents, like my father's gone already. But they've been having a hard time with mothers, fathers, as they get older, because they become, unfortunately, very demanding, overly demanding, and very difficult. And my father, even though he was ill at the end and really needs attention, he was just so kind about the whole thing, and very considerate of everybody. It made us want to come more. So what's happening to some of the other people in my life is kind of bringing that up, you know, making me appreciate that even more. He never really asked for very much, but in actuality, he got much more for my brother and myself because he was just so nice to be with. And I guess it's a message to all of us.
And I got bored, so I said, I want to go to an academic school So the University of Rochester was just there, so he financed my going there. In April of that year, I heard a harpsichord, and it was an epiphany. So now I wanted to come to New York and study the harpsichord. That's three changes in 3 years, plus not wanting to be a lawyer. He supported me unconditionally, as did my mother. But I remember him especially because on the occasion when I played in New York for the first time he came over, and I will never forget the look on his face, that it was all worth it, and that his love for me was unconditional. It set a very high bar for me as a father, which I have tried to attain.
I never knew my father. My parents were divorced when I was about three. And my mother's family, whenever I would do something naughty or bad, they would say, "You're just like your father." So I had these like kind of negative feelings about my father. And when I was about 13, I decided that I wanted to meet him. So I did. And we saw each other for a few times, but there was really nothing there. He was a stranger to me, and it sort of petered out. But there is a happy ending to the story, because my mother had gone to live with her parents, and I was an only grandchild, and I was an apple of my grandfather's eye. So he, my pop, was like a father to me. So I have a very special feeling grandparents, when I see my husband, who's a grandparent of not only his grandchildren from the first marriage, but my grandchildren, because he is their Papa Jay. I just have a wonderful feeling about grandparents, grandfathers in particular. So it was a happy ending to this film.
Please feel free at the end to put flowers in and think your own thoughts. And during brunch, share some more stories about your fathers. And I'm going to wrap this all up now. It's interesting how we find the people that we need in our lives. And I've been hearing that, that if we don't have a father, we find fathers. I always felt that my father did such a good job that I didn't need any other fathers. And I remember one job when I was quite young, when my boss tried to be a father to me. And I didn't say it to him because he was my boss, but I went home afterwards and said, "Why is he trying to be my father? I have a father. I don't need any others." Now, Rose was one of my mothers. I think I needed more mothers, and my father knew that. So one of the things that he did was to make sure that my grandmother took care of us. And so when my mother went to work, my grandmother was always there when we woke up and stayed on with us longer than she might have because I was old enough to babysit. But my father felt that it was important that I not be put in charge of my siblings because he wanted them to continue to love me. He knew that if I were in charge, they wouldn't. So I appreciate him for so much of his wisdom, that he knew that about his children, that he wanted to do as much as he could to not only raise independent people, but also to do as much as he could to support our relationships with each other. And so now, as we're going through one of his transitions, and that is that all of us came to the homestead to help my father with my mother's transition from a hospital into rehab, and she will be under nursing care in a nursing home for the rest of her life because he really cannot care for her anymore. But she's nearby, and he goes over there and has his midday meal with her every day for $4. He can get a very nutritious meal. And what he's been saying to his children is, I never wanted you to have to do this. I wanted to be able to do everything. To which we have said to him, but Dad, you raised us to be independent. And you raised us to love you and to love each other. And that's what we're doing. And you're allowing us to help you. And no one should have to ever have to go through all of this alone. So my father now, who's approaching 95, is learning to be more graceful in accepting. All the years that he was so gracious in giving, now he's learning to be gracious in accepting. And what a lesson it is for us in that as well. In conclusion, Obama loves being a father. President Obama says that being a father to Malia and Sasha is the most important job he has. At the same time, growing up without a father himself, the president understands all the different ways that fathers can be absent and can leave their families. So, what he has done is started the President's Fatherhood and Mentoring Initiative, which I found out about, and it's really quite wonderful. And so I'm going to put this up on my Facebook page and other places. This is a wonderful program where fathers can tune in and can really find out more about being a good father. This is a little different from that which Bonnie will tell you about, the Fatherhood Initiative, but it's the President's own special Fatherhood and Mentoring Initiative. Because fatherlessness is a growing crisis in America, and one that really undergirds so many of the challenges that our families are facing. And when they're not around, kids are more likely to drop out of school, to use drugs, or to become young parents themselves. And so it's a very important thing that, that we support all of these efforts. The final poem by Andrea Hollander Moody. And it's called My Father's Green Flannel Shirt. And it reminded me of my dad's shirts because I'm of the generation that when I started college, we didn't wear dresses. We wore jeans and flannel shirts. So when I would come home, I would raid the closet and I would take my father's flannel shirts back to school with me and I would wear them. It made me look cool and it also kept my dad around me. So this is called My Father's Green Flannel Shirt. He wore it when he moved, start again, he wore it when he mowed the grass, walked the dog, lounged with the Sunday papers. Whether it was his favorite, I'm not sure, the way I'm not sure if he cared for me more than my brother. When I was a child, he would pull me aside sometimes and tell me a secret, perhaps about his sister or one of the brothers he wasn't speaking to. A few times about my mother, whom I knew he loved, but always something that nagged at him. Afterwards, he would tell me not to tell anyone, then walked away whistling the way Alec Guinness in The Bridge of the River Kwai walked away whistling when they let him out of solitary confinement, as if he knew something wonderful and important, and no one could scare it out of him. Sometimes at dinner, my father would whistle that same tune, wink at me. How I loved being in cahoots with him, loved feeling chosen, being the one selected to receive. I took each secret into me and kept it. I wish you, all of you fathers, a happy Father's Day, and happy Father's Day to your fathers and your sons who are fathers. It is a wonderful holiday. I'm glad it became commercialized so that we still have it. And keep our fathers in our hearts every day of the year. Thank you.